rock.
On Christ the solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking. Sand, so stop your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking. Sand, so stop your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking. Sand, so stop your feet and clap your hands.
Welcome to First Christian Church on this Palm Sunday. We're so glad that you're here. Before I forget, Jillian asked me to remind everyone, on your table is going to be an RSVP for the Maundy-Thursday dinner this Thursday evening. If you would fill that out and put it in the baskets, there'll be baskets at the front and the back doors of the church that you can put that in. And as we were singing that song, My Feet Are on the Rock, it just made me think of life in general, changes all around us in our world and our environment and our work environment. There's so much uncertainty, and we feel like we're on shifting sands and sometimes quicksand, and we don't know what news media believe, and we don't know what information is right and how to make our best judgment. But we know that if we put our feet on the rock of God, the rock of our salvation, that is not changing and not moving. So you put your faith, your hope, your trust in God, and let your feet be on the rock. And that was a sermon for me I needed this morning. So rise as you're able, and we're going to sing Hosanna.
may be seated.
Okay. Good morning. Would you guys all join me for prayer? Gracious and loving God, as we gather today on this Palm Sunday, we remember the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, greeted with shouts of Hosanna and strewn with palm branches. Just as the crowds welcomed Jesus with joy and adoration, may our hearts be filled with reverence and praise for the King of Kings, who humbly rode into our lives to bring salvation and hope. Lord, on this day, we are reminded of the call to serve. Be your hands and your feet in a world in need. Lord, grant us the grace to follow the example of Jesus, who washed the feet of his disciples and showed us the true meaning of servant leadership. Lord, help us to see opportunities to serve others with compassion, humility, and love, just as your Son Jesus did. May our actions reflect your light and love, bringing comfort to the afflicted, healing to the brokenhearted, and hope to the despairing. Lord, guide us to reach out to those who are marginalized and forgotten, embodying your message of inclusivity, acceptance for true greatness is found in humble service. Strengthen us to be faithful disciples, committed to living out your kingdom values in our daily lives. Now, as one family, united in faith, let us all join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass. Not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We're going to sing a hymn today that we often sing on Palm Sunday. And because it's Palm Sunday, I'm going to invite you all to stand as you are able as we share this hymn together. Tell me the stories of Jesus.
As we gather together on this Palm Sunday, before I move behind, I want to talk out front for a second. I witnessed the most amazing thing this week. It was right here in this building. And it happened that this week, we as a congregation, because you know anything that happens when you're not here still affects you, right? You know that. We as a congregation encountered someone that was in need of housing and homeless. And that, I understand, is... No. Was that me this time, Teresa? Okay. I do cause a lot of problems. I'm not steel. But so maybe it's me. Probably so. But I witnessed a ministry here that was amazing. Not only did I see people go to work in a way that was able to find a safe place for this person until something more permanent could be established, but as this person was getting ready to leave the building in order to be taken to a safe place, I saw hands go to work. I saw the hands of Jillian and the hands of Beth. But really, they were your hands because you're the ones that made it possible. And I saw them take out a bag, and within less than a minute, that bag had in it easy to get to food. It had washcloths. It had toothpaste, toothbrush, toiletries, had a few fun snacks in it. I was like, wow. You know, I've been serving churches for 40 years, and that's a rare thing to see. And I tell you that because so often we forget when we give our offerings on Sunday that those offerings are what make that happen.
Amen.
We forget that. We forget that those offerings that we make not only make this they make this building available to this community. But not only do they make this building available, but when someone walks through our doors, when you're not even here, you touch their lives.
Amen.
Because of the gifts that you make available. So as we gather this week around this table like we always do in this moment of gifts, you will always hear me call it the table of gifts. Because we start with our gifts. They're not payment. They're gifts. You know, at Christmas, I don't know about you, but I'm more excited about the gifts that I give and put under the tree than I am about the ones that might be under there for me. If we could establish that kind of joy with the gifts that we give here, just think about what a difference we can make in this community. So remember, when you give your gifts, that you are making the hands and feet of Jesus walk, talk, reach out, even when you're not in this building. And it's those gifts that make that happen. So as we gather around this table, we have the chance to put our gifts in. And to get excited about those gifts because of all of the changes that they can make. But we also have the opportunity, and you can do that. There's many ways you can do that. I think you can even put them in the baskets on the tables. And of course, there's offering plates, and there's online. And if you've got a question on how you give your gifts, see any of us. We can help you with that, okay? So I think you know the ways that you can do it. And if you don't, I'm serious. We will help you make that connection. So with excitement, give your gifts. And also know that in addition to those monetary gifts you give, there's other gifts you give too. I encourage you in this time after you take communion and you go back to your seat, I encourage you to use those phones that you have. Maybe not to run through the news feed, but to use this moment as an opportunity to be in contact with someone that you love or that you care about, and just to take that moment to send them a text or a smiley and say, I love you, I'm thinking about you, or just happened to be sitting in church and I thought, wow, I miss you, or whatever it is. But use those phones as tools, because they can be tools to help you connect to the world. And when you come to eat of the bread and drink of the cup, light those candles. Light those candles as a way of remembering the hurt and the pain in the world. And every time we light one, it's another flicker of light in the world. So light those candles. And if there's still more that you want to say, then write a note, write a prayer concern, write a joy, and place it on the cross where those can be gathered. This is the table of gifts. And what a joyful table it is. And in the giving of our gifts, we receive the most beautiful gift of all. We receive the gift of God's infinite love. We receive the gift that says, no matter where you are, what you're doing, where you've been, my bread will feed you and my cup will quench your thirst. So we gather at this table, and it was, if we, you know, we historically, we may not be totally accurate, but we know that there was a Holy Week. And this is the week that we observe that Holy Week that there was. Whether this is the same week on the Roman calendar or not, but it's the week that we gather to remember that Holy Week that Jesus had with his disciples. And we know that it was in this Holy Week, as he was coming into Jerusalem for the big Passover meal, that he gathered in Matthew, Mark, and Luke on the night of the Passover with his disciples, the most joyous celebration in all Judaism, because it was the celebration of their release from captivity, their release from powers that be, from empire. And as they found themselves in a troubled world with an empire that seemed too big and too vicious, Jesus sat at the table with his disciples, and in their tradition, he took bread that he then blessed, and he broke it. And as he gave it to his disciples, he said to them, "This is my body broken for you. Whenever you eat it in remembrance of me." And after they had celebrated that wonderful Passover observation of liberation, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is a new covenant." Remember our new covenant of last week? Not something brand new, but once again, God comes back to us and says, "Okay, guys, here we go again." Jesus said, "This is a new covenant." God says, "Here we go again. This time I came in human form so you can see what it means to live a life of love." And he took the cup and he said, "I give you a new covenant, that you love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and your neighbor as yourself." My friends, every week when we gather at this table and we take a little piece of this bread and we drink from this cup, we do this in remembrance of him. As we gather to come at this table and to receive these gifts from God, I remind you that there are options, because God always gives us options, right? If you want to participate in intinction, and I understand that some of you don't, and I even know why some of you don't, and I understand that, and I appreciate that, so don't. There's a place on each side where you can come and you can participate in communion without intinction. If intinction has a particularly special meaning to you, to come and to break bread and to dip it in the cup, then if you come to this table, you will be served by intinction. But no matter how you choose to receive the gifts of God are yours. So come. Come and celebrate and eat from the bread of life and the cup of salvation. Let us come. Thank you.
Bless all of us as we reflect together, holiest of weeks. Bless our minds, our hearts, during our time at the table today, as we seek the grace given to us by you. Amen. Amen. Lord God of all, accept our offering of money this day, but also the offering of our lives. Excuse me. Help us to live simply, generously, and courageously, that our life may point to you. Amen.
Is anyone here?
a beautiful offering to God. Thank you. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the lectionary. It is from the Gospel of Mark. It begins at the 11th chapter, verses 1 through 11. It is the telling of Jesus's entrance into Jerusalem in the processional of palms. If you would like to stand for the reading, you are invited to do so. There is no obligation to do so. Here begins the reading of the Holy Scripture. Listen for the word of God. When they, meaning Jesus and his disciples, when they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he, Jesus, sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing, untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy palms that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were saying, "Hosanna," which means "save us." "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he, Jesus, entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Here ends the reading of the Holy Gospel. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Would you join me in prayer? God, may the words that are in my mouth and the thoughts that are in our hearts and our minds be acceptable in your sight. Amen. What a game. Yeah? You know what I'm talking about, right?
Yeah.
What a game. Ed, where are you? Okay. Nancy, I know you were watching, you and Chris. Who else was watching? Oh, okay. Now the hands are going, what a game. Right? Which game? I hear people saying, can you even believe it? NC State, the Wolfpack, right? Yeah. Right, last night. Boy, came into the end. I was already telling Ed, you know, it's been a good ride, but I think it's over. Ed was agreeing with me. It's over. It's over. And then, right? There's a tie. There's a tie. What a match, right? I knew that both of these teams were going to be hungry, didn't you? In their own way, both Cinderella teams, both not where they're supposed to be. I knew they were going to be hungry, two powers at each other's throat. Finally, it goes into overtime. And finally, the Wolfpack pulls it out, right? That cardiac pack, yeah? Ooh, Ed's heart was racing. He checked his to see what his was. I wouldn't even check mine. I think there's better ways to get your aerobic exercise. What a game. Let's look at Mark. You know me well enough by now. This is what, the fourth week maybe that I've been here with you, and you know that I'm going to teach. You know, that's the way we start. We start teaching. So let's take a few minutes and just talk about Mark. I want you to understand a little bit about Mark. You know there's four Gospels, right? And you know that we've talked about John. Now we're going to talk about Mark. Scholars feel, even it's not the first one in the New Testament, right? What's first? Good for you, Matthew, and then Mark. But scholars pretty much agree that Mark was the first gospel, the earliest gospel written. And because Matthew, Mark, and Luke have so much in common, scholars also believe that Matthew and Luke had a copy of Mark, or at least pieces of Mark, when they wrote their gospel, and they think that there was another source going around that, I'm going to tell you a long story, but basically the short version is, there was another source that's called Q floating around, and that Matthew, Mark, and Luke probably had access, particularly Matthew and Luke, to Q as well as Mark. Mark's the shortest of the three gospels. It was written around, scholars pretty much agree that it was probably written somewhere around the year 70 CE or AD, depending on what you use. CE is just common error, and AD is after the birth of Jesus. So it was written somewhere around the year 70. So what is happening in the year 70 when Mark is telling the gospel to the people Mark is talking to, which probably were Galileans, but don't know that for sure. But he spends a lot of time in Galilee. There's a big empire out there. Anybody know who that empire is? Rome. Oh, are they big and are they mighty? In fact, they're not so much different from that Egyptian empire. Remember that Egyptian empire back in the Exodus that had all of the Jewish people in slavery? Okay, this is a new kind of slavery. They're in their own towns and their own communities, and the wealthy Jews of the day, which often would have been your Jews associated with power and the temple and stuff, had sort of bought into the Roman Empire. They were just trying to survive in the midst of this. But the big Roman Empire was really, really, really oppressive to just the common folk. It was an oppressive place to be. It wasn't that much different than Egypt. So when Mark is writing around 70, things are getting really hot and tense because maybe 68, they don't think he was quite there in 70, because in the year 70, something traumatic happens. Anyone know what happens in the year 70? Rome burns, and the temple is destroyed. So we're kind of in another crisis like we were back in Egypt, right? So here we have the Jewish people, the common, ordinary people. I'm not talking about your powerful people. I'm talking about your everyday common people. They're under this huge empire. And Mark is writing to them in 70. And Mark is telling them, we don't think Mark was there for the destruction of the temple because he doesn't say it. That's how they date him. But he knows something is getting ready to happen, and it's not going to be good with Rome, because that power that was there when Jesus was there is only getting stronger. And the conflict that was there when Jesus lived about 30 years earlier or 40 years earlier is there, but it's even stronger. So it's in this setting that Mark is telling us his stories about Jesus. See, it's important to know what's going on for the people who are hearing it, because he's telling them a story that's happened 40 years earlier. Does this make sense? So he's telling a story to a people who are oppressed, and he's telling us a lot. Now, I love the Gospel of Mark. I'm going to watch my time. I'm not going to take you over. I absolutely adore the Gospel of Mark. And it's kind of funny. It just kind of shows you how quirky my own personality is, because most ministers, it's the gospel they want to stay away from the most. And I'll tell you why. I just love Mark. I'm a little bit of a cynic. And so Mark and I think would have gotten along really, really well. Mark, in fact, I had to smile when we read this. Mark has a lot of interesting things that happen in his gospel. And if you're someone who likes to work with colored pencils and stuff like that, Mark is a great gospel to sit down with, Jillian and and Beth, to sit down with and take a bunch of colored pencils and start boxing and underlying patterns that you see. It's a lot of fun. Because one of the things that Mark does, it's the shortest gospel, and some people say that it's basically a passion story, and passion comes from the Greek word meaning what? Anyone know? To suffer. So most of, about half of Mark is the whole passion story, meaning Holy Week through Easter. And the first part, people say it's really an introduction with a passion story. But he moves this along quickly. And so he's always using the word immediately, 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 immediately. In fact, in our reading today, I think I read it three times. I smiled, you know, to myself, ah, there it is. There's that immediately. So he does that. He also has another little interesting thing that is that's crazy, and that is that Mark has insiders and outsiders. Now, the insiders are the disciples, right? They're the 12, the close friends who follow him. The outsiders are everybody else. But what's so tricky and funny and interesting about Mark's gospel is that as Mark is telling his gospel, the insiders never get it. They never get it. They're like, duh, what? But the outsiders always get it. They always see what Jesus is doing. But the insiders are there going, I don't get it. Okay? They miss the point. Every time, go through, mark it, and see how many times he says to them, do you still not understand? Mark says to them in this gospel, I think there's a lot of wisdom in that. I think we as insiders sometimes don't get what some of those on the outside may get. So I think there's a lot of wisdom in Mark's insight into insiders and outsiders. Mark also has, there's just so many fun things in Mark. My Bible, I was doing it this week and I was having such fun with all my markers. I must have had 6 or 8 different colors going because there's things that you just highlight and you say, there it is again, there it is again. And one of the really interesting things about Mark is 3 times in Mark you hear the phrase, this is Jesus the Son of God. Okay, you hear it 3 times. Now, here's the interesting thing. You hear it at the very beginning. Mark says, this is the gospel, the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the anointed one, which means the king, which means they're expecting a king like King David. That's the kind of king we're talking about, is a King David who's going to come in with power, or a Moses, as Matthew will compare him to, who will come in and deliver the people who are oppressed from this oppressive empire, right? And so at the very beginning, Mark says, I'm telling you the good news about Jesus, the Son of God, okay? Right smack dab in the middle, Jesus is going to predict 3 times that he's going to suffer and die, and guess who doesn't get it every time? The disciples. They don't get it. In fact, the first time this happens is Jesus says to them, you know, people are saying I'm Elijah, people are saying I'm all of this and all of that. Who do you say that I am? And Peter has a motive of wisdom. Peter says, you are the Christ, the anointed one. And Jesus says to him, God revealed that to you, okay? So he gets it, an insider gets it. And then Jesus starts to tell them that he must suffer and die. First time of 3, and what does Peter do? Peter pulls him over and he says, no, 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 Jesus, you're not going to suffer and die. You're the Messiah. You're the anointed one. You're going to come in with great power. You're going to overthrow the Roman Empire. You're going to do these marvelous things. And what does Jesus say to this insider? Get behind me, Satan. We thought for a minute an insider had insight. But they didn't. Peter misunderstood. He misunderstood what it meant for the Messiah to come. So the second time is right smack dab in the middle when Peter says it, doesn't understand it, but says it. And then the third and final time that we hear it is at the end. And at the end, after the crucifixion and he has died, There is a Roman centurion, insider, outsider? Outsider. There's a Roman centurion standing under the cross, and the Roman centurion looks up and says, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Do you know all that was going on in Mark? And then this is my favorite part of all, and this is the part why most ministers like it, and I'm not going to preach on it next week because I'm going to preach on John, I think. John's always an option for Easter, but I thought about it, and if I was going to do it, I couldn't do this, but I'm going to do it here. If you look at the original ending of Mark, Mark has been added on to by scribes who tried to fix Mark. Okay? There's about 8 or 10 extra verses at the very end, and we know that Mark didn't write them, and we know that scribes literally translated things by hand, and so they tried to fix Mark. Because what Mark, this is the way Mark's gospel ends. The women, you know who they are, on the first day of the week, they go to the tomb. They see a man there. There's a stone rolled away. No one, by the way, ever witnesses a resurrection. All we have in the Bible is the witness to an empty tomb. Okay? We have a witness to an empty tomb. And so the women come, the stone's rolled away, they look in, Jesus isn't there. The man, the other gospels say angel, say, who are you looking for? You seek Jesus. He is not here. He has risen. Tell his disciples to go to Galilee. That's appropriate for Mark because that's where most of his ministry is and that's where it starts. Tell his disciples to go to Galilee and he will meet them then. And the last words in the book of Mark say, and they went out with fear and trembling and said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. That's the end of the Gospel of Mark. I get it. These women 2 days earlier stood at the foot of the cross and they watched this man be crucified on a cross and killed. And dadgum, if it wasn't scary, because they knew how costly discipleship could be. They had witnessed it firsthand 2 days earlier. What happens when you speak against Rome and you speak up for the poor? You get yourself crucified. Not just killed. I mean, shoot me. That's okay. Hang me on a cross and put nails through my hands and torture me? No, I'm not up for that. How about you? So I totally get why that gospel ends with those women went away and they said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. Dadgum, I'd have been afraid too, and I think I'd have been right there with them. Obviously, we know that at some point someone had some courage and went forth. So we know that didn't last. But I can understand it. I can totally understand it. So I want to teach you something that was happening on Palm Sunday. And I'm going to teach you this. I didn't learn it in seminary. You're not going to read it in the Bible. I learned it from two scholars who have studied ancient history and they knew what would have been happening. The scholars and theologians are John Dominic Crossan and Marcus Borg. And they have written a wonderful history not in terms of exactly how events happened, but history in the sense of understanding the setting, the historical setting, and what would have been going on the last week in the Gospel of Mark. And they use Mark because Mark is the only gospel who literally counts the days of the week off. You can follow it, and you can move Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. In Mark. It's the only one you can do that with, but you can follow it. So they chose to use Mark to give us an idea of what was going on historically. And one of the most powerful things that I have ever learned, I learned from them in this book. And here's what it is. I wish we had a map of, I wish I had a map of Jerusalem to show you. But imagine with me Jerusalem. Okay, I'm opposite you, and since I'm a little dyslexic, it won't matter. This will be the, this is your west, right? Is this your west? By my hands. And this is your east, okay? So here's Jerusalem, all right? Here's the west, and over here is the ocean, all of the water, not in, right next to Jerusalem, but going west. Caesar Tiberius had a representative called a governor to oversee Jerusalem. And that governor's name was Pontius Pilate. And that governor lived by the water, like all rich people do, right? They get houses on the beach, yeah? Well, Caesar had a wealthy home on the water, and that's where Pontius Pilate lived. But every time that there was a huge, big festival, and Passover is the biggest one of all, in Jerusalem, because the Roman Empire was concerned about unrest, and they were concerned about people rising up against them as the power, what would happen is the person representing Tiberius, Pontius Pilate, would come into Jerusalem from the west gate, and he would come in a processional. And that processional would be mighty horses, soldiers dressed up, drummers drumming. Getting the picture? What's coming in the west gate? And they would do it the week before Passover, so that they could be in Passover to make sure that they kept the natives in order and that the power of Rome was present. Now, not only do we have Pontius Pilate coming in on the west gate with all of his power and might and his fancy equipment and his attire and his horses, I don't know if you know this or not, but the early Caesars were thought to be the god, and so they carry with them the title Son of God. Uh-oh. You see where this is going? So on the west gate, we have Caesar coming in through Pontius Pilate with all of his glory on fancy horses, with a bunch of soldiers, probably dressed to the T, drummers drumming, and there's a procession as he enters from the west. The plot thickens. On the east, coming down from a little place in Galilee, Jesus gathers with the peasants. He gathers with the peasants outside of Jerusalem's east gate. He gets on a colt, some say a donkey, a young animal. Basically, what we need to know is it wasn't big and it wasn't royal. He gets on a donkey. And his followers who have seen him do all of these miracles cry out, Hosanna, save us, save us, save us. They're looking for Moses. They're looking for David. They're looking for Jesus to come in and to literally overthrow the kingdom coming in the west gate. And so they gather around him, so hopeful that this will be the week that the Roman Empire dies. And they put their cloaks on the ground, and they grab tree branches of whatever they were around them, and they throw them on the ground. And at the same time, opposite side of the city, that Caesar is coming in with all of his might and greatness and royalty, Jesus is coming in the east gate on a donkey with limbs and the clothing of the poor and the peasants. Whoa. And that, my friends, is how Holy Week begins. Here we are. Here we are at the door of Holy Week. Sit down, buckle up. It's going to be a ride. It's going to be a ride this week. You know what's at stake. You've seen the setting. It's already out there. It's going to be a week. Buckle up and sit down. Spoiler alert! Spoiler alert. The guy on the donkey, he's going to win in overtime. Amen. I've been forgetting to extend an invitation before we have our closing hymn. If you're with us and you would like to be a part, officially a part of this family, we would love to have you. And if you want to come forward, we would love to have that. If you don't want to come forward, that's okay too. We get that. We'll be glad. Any elder, raise your hand. Elders, raise your hand. Jillian, raise your hand too. Any of us would be glad to talk to anyone who would like to become an official part of this family. You're already in our family. But if you want full adoption, let us know. Let us stand as we sing together our closing hymn. reminder, Green Chalice meeting just a few minutes in that corner, won't be long. Go out into the world with courage. Go out into the world and bring into the world the love of God and the peace of Christ. Go out into the world, and every time you see a stranger, look into their eyes and seek to see the DNA of God within them. Go out with peace, go out with grace. Amen.